Friends, our apologies for that snag. I was saying that this is perhaps the first ever panel discussion on a topic associated, linked to the Northeast that is happening in our university at the Azim Premji University. So a very warm welcome to you for coming to this discussion. And on the August 2015 Naga Accord signed between the Government of India and the Nationalist Socialist Council of Nagaland, which in fact is in the form of a framework agreement. So before I tell you more about the subject and introduce my panelists, I have to say just a few words about myself. What I wish to say is that I'm hardly qualified to moderate this discussion. I know something about the Northwest frontier and Baluchistan and the other side of the subcontinent because I work in West Punjab and I have an ancestry that comes from there, but I know very little about the Northeast. My only sort of claim to moderate this is that I'm Vikas's friend. And the other one perhaps may be that we have a topic on Assam and the Northeast in one of the courses that I teach called Discourses of Nationalism. So what I'll do really is that I'll play a minimalist role. And as far as our panelists are concerned, we have a very exciting panel. We have three gentlemen, two from Nagaland, one from Manipur. We have Mr. Theja Therieh, President of the Chakisang Hoho Kohima, Chairman Media Cell, Nagaland Tribes Council. He's a postgraduate in environmental sciences, and he's made important contributions to the public debate on census delimitation and reservation in Nagaland. He's used public interest litigation to challenge unfair government policies related to delimitation and reservation. And therefore, he's played a major role in shaping the delimitation policy of the government vis-a-vis the Northeast in general and Nagaland in particular. So a very warm welcome to you. And we hope to learn a lot from you. We also have Mr. Khekiye Sema. He's a consultative member of the ACAUT Against Corruption and Unabated Taxation, a mass-based movement of Nagaland. Mr. Sema is a retired civil servant, and he's also a regular contributor to Nagaland's English newspapers. In his assignment as a civil servant, he was active in instituting the Hornbill Festival, which is a seven-day tourist festival, become very popular in Nagaland, and has also placed Nagaland squarely on the international map. Mr. Sema is also very well-versed with a large range of administrative and political issues that concern Nagaland, and welcome you, sir. We look forward to listening to you. We also have with us Mr. Pradip Phanjoubam. He's the editor of the Imphal Free Press, an English daily published from Imphal. He's made the few contributions that presented a very well-grounded perspective on the Northeast, and the writing that he does is not based on government records only or on press notes that have been issued by the government. He was a fellow of the Indian Institute of Advanced Study at Shimla during 2012-2014. And we look forward to a book by him, which will be shortly published in January or December by Routledge. That is December 2015, January 2016. The Northeast Question, Conflicts and Frontiers. We will definitely use that book in our university, in the courses that we teach here. Welcome to you, and we look forward to your views about the subject. Now, Azim Premji University is only 5 years old, And therefore, we are only now beginning to have create an interest in the Northeast. We don't have much of the Northeast in our courses as yet, but we hope to have a lot of the Northeast in several of our courses. But the one local expert that we have, which is Vikas, is an extraordinary phenomenon in his own right. He's an engineer turned economist, turned political economist of censuses and quantitative data, turned historian. So there are several caps that he wears. And we really look forward to his views on the subject also this afternoon. And he's the one who's been instrumental in creating this event this afternoon. The issue, the 2015 Naga Accord, as far as the issue is concerned, we all know that both in Nagaland and in the Northeast, we have a range of questions that tie up with identity politics of all kind. There are conflicts, there are divisions, but there's also a lot of sharing both within Nagaland and between Nagaland and the other sister states of the Northeast. So given this kind of a situation, it is pertinent to ask whether this accord, which is in a sense a third of its kind, will it work in the long run? It's been signed between the Government of India and the Nationalist Socialist Council of Nagaland, or more precisely with one faction of that Nationalist Socialist Council. So will it really work? Is this faction, the IM faction, first among equals? There are also issues that may create a divide between people in Nagaland, people in Manipur, in Arunachal, in Assam. There is another kind of fracture that we see sometimes between the Nagas of Nagaland and those of Manipur. There has always been talk of pan-Naga organizations. So given all this, given this kind of scenario, the point really is that will young Naga men and women be willing to live out this accord? Will they welcome it? And will they be satisfied with it? Or will this agreement, in fact, be the source of further discord? So with these few remarks, I welcome all of you. And may I first call upon Mr. Theja Therieh to come and present his views in about 20 minutes. Each of you could do that in about 20 minutes, and after that, we'll open it up for discussion. Is that fine? Right.
Professor Sethi, the chairman of and moderator of this panelist discussion, we thank you for the brief introduction that has been made. In fact, I am amazed. He said it honestly, he don't know anything about Nagaland or Northeast. But the fact is, few people who are outside Nagaland and Northeast knows more than what we know about Nagaland and Northeast. And Azim Prem University, this is a new name. I came to know this university when Professor Vikas visit Nagaland. He visit Nagaland several times, several years, and then we met in three or four occasions. And when I was having an interaction with him, he knows Nagaland more than any of us. Last night, we were discussing with our senior, Mr. Khekiye Sema. He was also quite amazed how he came to know about our history, about our great leaders, our national, we call it national leaders, Naga national leaders. And he knows so much about this, the statistic of every nook and corner. And we appreciate him for taking great interest. And these are the person who are connecting an isolated state like Nagaland with the mainland India. It's very important, and he's been playing such a great role. And he is not giving up. He will continue to do so. and then the books which he's going to publish, and what he is having in mind, I feel that it is not just writing a book. Maybe something which he's keeping from us, we are yet to know. That is why the people in Nagaland, in the isolated areas, they mistook him as agent of India. And truly, he is an agent of India. Faculty members and my dear student friends, it is a great privilege to come down here, far away from Nagaland, talking about Nagaland. I'm also feeling very great because you all came here because you have a great interest to know about Naga history, the conflict which has been there for the last century. It's a small state, an isolated state. Yet, the conflict is one of the oldest conflicts in the Indian history. And I feel solution to this will be the pride of the nation. And this is our belief. My two senior panelists, they are experienced in government and in the media. They will share their experience. I am just a citizen who is born in the conflict, and we form an organization out of the conflict, and that is how I'm here, just to testify how is the situation there and what do we expect from the people in the mainland India. That is my concern here. I'm very grateful to Professor Vikas for giving this opportunity. I will be just going brief. I will not be taking even 20 minutes. And later on, we will try to have more interaction. The peace accord, there are many peace accords that have come and gone. There are some accords which could bring a solution, a permanent solution. But there are accords which, rather than bringing a solution, it creates division. It creates more division, and it multiplies the problem. I want you to know which accord, the very accord which government of India and IM have signed recently. When the peace accord was signed between the government of India and the NSCN IM, a leading faction in Nagaland, on the 3rd of August, there was huge celebration in most of the Naga inhabited areas. Naga spread over in Manipur, Arunachal, Assam, Myanmar, and in the entire Northeast. People celebrate. But in the mainland India, Nagaland, where is the mainland Nagaland, when this peace accord was announced, it is a state under Indian Union. The people were shocked. And there was uneasy silence everywhere. The neighboring states too. Our panelists will talk about how Manipur state react to this. But they were also shocked and surprised and expressed their anxiety and worry as to what would the will happen to the territorial conflicts and also the age-old fragile relationship of the Nagas with our neighboring states. This is one thing which they all have shared the concern in several occasions. The citizens of the state of Nagaland too are astonished and concerned about our relationship with the alienable neighbors of the citizens of the state of, the northeastern states. They need to build mutual trust and cordial relationship with our neighboring states is equally important as our political solution for the Nagas. The first reaction itself clearly signals there's a possibility of sacrificing the interest and the right of the citizens of the state of Nagaland while giving a solution for the Nagas spread over in the northeastern states and Myanmar. The citizens are kept in total darkness about the contents of the accord. And while asking the people to support the accord without even disclosing the contents of the accord, which is meant for us, is amusing. At the same time, it is an imposition which is not acceptable in a democratic system. The Nagas have seen 1975 Shillong Accord that has failed to provide lasting political solution and subsequently lead to discord and bloodshed amongst the Naga national workers. It can be seen as how an accord can damage our fragile relationship when all stakeholders are not taken on board for an inclusive solution to any conflict. The present conflict, accord is signed with only one group, and therefore it can never usher in any honorable or acceptable solution to the Nagas. The question here is either all the political groups comes together and talk to the government of India, or government of India initiate talks with all the political groups and the stakeholders to bring a lasting and also honorable solution, because it has to work out a broad-based consensus for a lasting political solution where everyone has to be taken on board. The first sign of Naga resistance was seen in the formation of Naga Club in 1918. And the Naga political issue started with solution, a submission of memorandum to British Statutory Commission, Simon Commission, on the 10th of January 1929, seeking to be left alone to decide our own future destiny should the British leave India. That was the memorandum which was submitted. On 9th of July 1947, Naga delegation met Mahatma Gandhi in Old Delhi, who assured the Naga delegation saying, "Nagas have every right to be independent." In 1947, July 27-29, a 9-point agreement was signed with Sir Akbar Haidari, which allowed the Nagas to be either remains within the Indian Union or declare independence after the expiry of 10 years agreement. In 1947, August 14, British occupied Naga areas declared independence, a day ahead of Indian Independence Day, and telegram was sent across the world. 1951, May 16, a voluntary Naga plebiscite was conducted across Nagaland, where 99.9% of the people signed for Naga self-determination under the banner of Naga National Council. Subsequently, in 1956, Nagaland declared a republic with formation of a federal government of Nagaland, FGN. On December 1st, 1957, Naga Hill District of Assam State and the Tuensang area were formed into a separate administered unit. This visibly did not inspire the Nagas, who wanted to have a separate state then. The Naga People's Convention submitted the 16-point memorandum to the Prime Minister, Sri Jawaharlal Nehru, and on 28th of August 1962, the Constitution 13th Amendment Bill was passed and Nagaland State was created on 4th of September 1962 as the 16th state of the Indian Union. It is an accepted norm that for signing an accord or any agreement, it has to be first discussed and rectified by both the conflicting parties. But the 16-point agreement was signed only by the Naga People's Convention signatories. It has not included the national workers. It was never a political agreement, but a memorandum submitted in the form of a resolution, and therefore the discord and the political problem still persists till today. The Nagas have a solid political history, and it is as old as 97 years since that back 1918, when the Naga people developed its political consciousness and formed Naga Club. The first and so far the only plebiscite was referendum was signed, conducted on the 16th of May 1951 under the banner of NNC. Today, the Naga plebiscite is as old as 64 years, and it remains valid and still relevant. The 64 years old Naga plebiscite is the only unquestionable foundation of Naga political issue and its movement. Therefore, no political movement can become unique or historical if the plebiscite 1951 is to be subtracted from our political standpoint. The issue of Naga integration figured in a 16-point memorandum of 1960 in between the Naga People's Convention and the Government of India. The 13th clause runs as follows: consolidation of contiguous Naga areas from all the Naga contiguous areas. The other Naga tribes inhabiting in the areas contiguous to the present state of Nagaland be allowed to join Nagaland if they so desire. That option was given. The history itself is self-explanatory, and the option of the clause. With the above in the background vis-a-vis the formative framework accord between Government of India and NSCN and IM, was now signed on the 3rd of August 2015 at Delhi, exclusively between the two entities. Nevertheless, as the world framework itself is inconclusive, and the stakeholders are kept in total darkness, the people are closely watching, particularly the much professed inclusiveness by no other than the official representative of Government of India, Sri Arun Ravi, the interlocutor, as to whether Government of India would act in letter and spirit or allow it to become just eyewash. The Government of India has unambiguously made its stand clear in the media more than once that the issue of Naga sovereignty and integration are not negotiable at the moment. It is equally unambiguous that the 3rd August 2015 framework is well within the ambit of the Indian Constitution. Under the present circumstances, it is imperative for the Nagas to accept the reality at a given situation. One of the two realities is the Government of India will not table the agenda on sovereignty under the present arrangement. Secondly, second reality is that the Naga territories in India will not be amalgamated in other words, that the status quo will remain by and large. As for the Nagas, the one and the only mandate given by the Nagas for Naga National Movement is 1951 plebiscite to struggle for a sovereignty, and there is no other basis mandated by the people. Therefore, any negotiation leading to acceptable settlement below the mandated movement, all the Naga political groups must reach a consensus by taking all stakeholders on board for a lasting political solution. The Nagas have experienced how the people suffer under the British divide and rule policy. How outsiders and foreign nationals were brought in to assimilate in our society, importing laborers, cheap laborers from outside. And today, the Government of India is trying to divide the Nagas by pushing one group against the other, by negotiating with only one group. To bring an exclusive settlement imposing on the others that will further divide the Naga people and encourage bloodshed yet again. The irony here is the government of India talked to one NPG, Naga National Political Group, and banned the other national political group. The peace process is set on full swing in one hand, and on the other hand, the entire Nagaland is placed under Armed Force Special Power Act by extending the entire Naga areas of Nagaland under the Disturbed Area Act. Trying to win the hearts of the people while using brute force is hostility, devoid of true spirit of healing towards permanent settlement. The people expect the government of India to show magnanimity and sincerity, to talk to everyone on to take everyone on board for a lasting political solution that can yield win-win for both the Nagas and the government of India. The Nagas have high hope that the government, under the decisive leadership of Sri Narendra Modi, who has taken a bold initiative to resolve the Naga political problem, will definitely leave no stone unturned to find a lasting political solution by taking all the stakeholders into his confidence. This is an opportune time for the Nagas to go through another event in our history that will usher in a new era of peace and prosperity. This is also an opportune time for not only Modi government, but all concerned Indian citizens to play a positive role and complementary role in making this negotiation work towards a reality, to realize our dream of peaceful coexistence. I sincerely wish to be a real Naga patriot and take pride in building a magnificent India. I extend my sincere appreciation to the organizers for this momentous occasion, creating an interface with the students, the faculty members, the intellectuals, the thinkers, who can definitely bridge the gap and take us forward to a cordial and harmonious relationship. Thank you.
I think it's okay. Yeah. Thank you very much. But I don't know if it's going to be a voice from Manipur, because I know, you know, there are two ways of looking at this, at any problem. One is to actually focus on the specific. The other is to take a macro vision. And I think both are important, that you have to, because when you look at the details, you see only the details without seeing the landscape. So I'm trying to look at it both ways. And here I think I will concentrate on the landscape, the bigger picture, so that we will know where to place each of these problems. And I think the problem, actually, it's a large issue, and it's also very complex. So even if I was to do the micro vision, I will not know where to begin, unless I'm given, say, time for 2 hours or something. Because it's going to be difficult to actually put them together into 20 minutes. So I'll just take a look at the broader picture of how the idea of the Northeast came about, and how in that very idea is embedded all these problems that we are seeing, the little problems. I will say little because it's only part of the Northeast problem, whether it's Naga problem, Mizo problem, or Manipur problem, whatever. It's part of that entirety called the Northeast. And how this idea of the Northeast came about is a bigger story, and it begins much, much earlier, in a sense that you know, it begins with colonialism. And you know, I was just thinking about it today, and when we talk about boundaries, for instance, when we're talking about demarcated and delineated boundaries. No, we're not just talking about the traditional concept of boundary. That the Northeast was actually, the boundaries in the Northeast are much, much earlier than anywhere in the anywhere else in the North, in India, in the Indian subcontinent. For instance, in 1846, after the first Sikh War, Kashmir came into the hands of the British by default, in a sense that the Kashmir was under the Sikhs at the time. when the Sikhs were conquered, Kashmir came into the hands of the British. And what they inherited with Kashmir was a boundary problem. And why they inherited that problem of boundary was because there was no boundary. This whole idea of boundary is alien to the entire, the rest of the world outside of Europe. And in Europe, they will have demarcated boundaries where the boundary is administered as intensely as a center, or maybe more intensely than the center, because you are always afraid of the boundary. These kind of things never happen, especially in the Asiatic societies, which is what, you know, in 1907, Curzon gave a speech. I mean, immediately after his retirement, he retired in 1905. And then after that, he gave a speech in Oxford. There's the famous Romanist lecture series. And 1907 was his lecture, and he gave it on. I mean, he was asked to give on any issue of relevant, because he was just retired as a viceroy. So they wanted something from him. So he gave that lecture on frontiers. And here he was specifying this problem, that the idea of the demarcated boundary is alien anywhere else apart outside of Europe. So when they came to India, they faced this problem. So the boundary making, and they were uneasy about a place without boundary. They were uneasy about unpossessed land. For instance, when you have, you come to Assam, and then immediately what they did was, you know, you set up a land revenue project where each thing had to be, it had to be backed up by land deed. So you had to own a land in terms of the government's term. Now you just can't say, I own this land. And this kind of problem was happening in a big way in Assam. And Assam at the time when the British came in was almost the entire Northeast, except for two principalities, Tripura and Manipur. So the boundary making process actually began there in the Northeast in 1826 when the Treaty of Yandabo was signed. And then this actually demarcated the boundary of Assam and British India and Manipur, in fact. So the Chinwin River was actually taken as a boundary. But Burma protested. Territory beyond the Chinwin was theirs. So ultimately the British conceded, because also thinking that it'll be easier for Mandalay to administer that area, which is known as the Kabo Valley. So they gave away Kabo Valley to the Burmese in 1834. And in 1834, they drew a line called the Pemberton Line. There was a British officer called Percy Brower, is a very PB Pemberton. So it's known as the Pemberton Line, he drew it. And then it was drawn by the mountain baseline principle, which is never accurate, because you don't know where the base of the mountain is. So that line was drawn in 1834. And then later on, again, in 1881, they set up another boundary commission, the British, in Manipur, somebody called James Johnson, he was the political agent. There was a problem with the Chasad Kukis. The Chasad Kukis, they live in the Bora area. And then what was happening was they had already weapons, firearms, and they were attacking the border villages, especially the Tangkhul villages in the Somra track, as well as within Manipur territory. So the British wanted to take care of that. So they sent punitive measures from Manipur, and the Chasad Kukis will claim that they are subjects of Burma. When the British tried to do it from the other side, they will claim that they were the subjects of Manipur. So Johnson came out with the idea of redemarcating that boundary. So in 1881, they set up the boundary commission. In 1882, they redrew the boundary. So it came to be known as Pemberton-Johnson line. And this, the logic was to actually extend the boundary a little so that the entire Chasad area will come into Manipur. And so that you cannot say that you belong to the other state when you are attacked from here or the vice versa. So ultimately, the Chasads were brought into Manipur territory. And according to Johnson, the problem ended there, that after that, the thing was settled. But again, in 1896, this was actually reconfirming that boundary. Boundary pillars were actually put along the border of Manipur and Burma. And this was done by another political agent called Maxwell. Colonel Maxwell sent some, I forget his name, the initials. But he put 38 boundary pillars along the Manipur border. And then also I'm forgetting, in the Nagaland sector, the was the tallest, the tall, Patkai. The Patkai was taken as, Patkai Ridge was taken as the boundary. I mean, it was just assumed. There was no demarcation as such. But in the Manipur sector, it was properly demarcated. That happened. And also on the other side, the, as I said, the British came to Assam and then they were very, very particular about their boundaries. On the Tibetan side, you had, no, I don't know if I'm going to take too long on this. On the Tibetan side, you had Sikkim. And then Sikkim boundary was drawn in 1890, which is much later than in, even in Assam. In 1890, they drew the boundary because they wanted to, and they drew it with China because that time they were recognizing China. But then what happened was 1893, they signed another treaty for the Yatung Trade Center in the Chumbi Valley in Tibet with the Chinese. But what happened was you signed a treaty with Chinese and then the Tibetans were not respecting it. And they kept complaining to the Chinese, and the Chinese were not able to do anything. So Curzon and before him, Lord Dufferin, they came to the conclusion that the idea of Tibet being controlled by China is a fiction. So we'll start dealing with Tibet directly instead of going through China. So what they started doing was to actually do that, to start dealing with Tibet. And what happened was at the time, the British, the Tibetans were also very suspicious of the British. And so they started, they were also trying to play off the British against the Russian. So, and there was a advisor to the Tibetan leader, Dalai Lama, the 13th Dalai Lama at the time, somebody called Dorji F. from Siberia. He's a Siberian, but then he the belonging to the Buryat tribe. I think I'm digressing too much, so I'll just put this to an end. And what happened was that Curzon was there at the time. Curzon thought Tibetans were getting too close to the Russians. And one thing about the British, they were never afraid of anybody else. They were only afraid of other European powers. So they were afraid of Russia. They didn't want Russia to come into Tibet. And they thought Russia was going to come into Tibet. So immediately, he wrote letters to the Dalai Lama, and Dalai Lama didn't read those letters. One of them returned without being open to Curzon. And what happened, and this Dalai Lama was sending missions to Russia and all that. So he became very suspicious of the Tibetans. So he sent a mission called the Young Husband Mission in 1904, and they forced a treaty on Tibet. And that again is another branch of the history as such, in a sense that the Chinese were worried. You sign a treaty with Tibet, it means recognizing Tibet. So the Chinese started doing their own diplomacy in Calcutta, and then tried to convince Curzon to actually do another treaty with China to recognize the Lhasa Treaty of 1904. But Curzon didn't agree. But fortunately for the Chinese, Curzon retired in 1905. And in England, there was a change of government from the conservative to the liberal. So they agreed to have another convention, the Peking Convention in 1906, which ratified the Tibetan Convention. As I said, this is another branch in the history of the place. So I will just come back to the central idea of the Northeast again. And here, one way to begin this study would be to actually go into another book, another theory actually, which somebody called James Scott has come out. Very controversial kind of a theory, but also very useful, that he is talking about the idea of Zomia, where you have the entire Southeast Asia massif, the mountainous massif, where it's not just in the Northeast, but so many places, right up to Yunnan. This kind of problem that the Northeast is facing is faced everywhere, from Vietnam, starting from Yunnan to Vietnam to Cambodia to Laos and Thailand, Upper Thailand, Burma, all these places. So he came out with a theory called Zomia, where he says that it is normally in the paddy states, he called it. It's not even a state in the European sense. The paddy states, you have the valley and the hills everywhere. And the valley, because of the productive atmosphere, because of the level of agriculture there, there's a bit of surplus there. And the state, in Frederick Engels' definition, is actually a mechanism for managing surplus. And this state evolves in these valleys, in small states evolve there. And they're always in conflict with the non-state population in the hills. There's this, and this kind of friction marks this entire territory, this entire Zomia. This is what he says. And I think there's a lot to learn from there, but although not everything that he says holds up to experience, in a sense that he was always talking about the valley states hegemony of the hills. But in Assam, you find that there's also the race from the hills into the valley. So there's always a two-way process, which is he doesn't see. James Scott. And one of the biggest criticism against James Scott has been that he ignores the voices of the Zomians. He's talking about Zomia. It's a very abstract kind of a theory that is coming out, but he has not actually taken the voice of Zomia into his theory. And in spite of all the controversial aspect of this of his theory, it is still very useful in understanding the problem here. And so in this light, I would say the problem of the Northeast that we are facing now is also about formerly non-state, or in James Scott's words, non-state-bearing populations coming to terms with the modern state, that you have modern states coming, and then you find yourself in a situation where you've been placed according to the convenience of the existing states into wherever the territory, that convenience, the boundary the convenience drew. And this is the problem that we are facing. And in this light, I'll just say one or two more points and then conclude. And on the Naga Accord, of course, I will just put the last paragraph, that the idea of the non-state has been there very strongly. In fact, you know, if you take the Tibetan case, for instance, after the Chinese invaded, the Mao Zedong's army invaded Tibet in 1950, Tibet tried to appeal to the United Nations. At that time, it was called UNO, United Nations Organizations, now, of course, the UN. They tried to appeal there. And nobody was willing to sponsor that appeal, not India. India, of course, they had that Panchil agreement with China and all that. Britain didn't want to do it. America was already sponsoring anti-communist movement in Tibet. He was and supporting, besides Chiang Kai-shek, there was also supporting Tibetan insurgency in Tibet. And in spite of that, they also refused. And one of the arguments they came out with was that you don't know what to do because UN is a statist organization. A state has to appeal, and if an aggression has been made by one state on another state, then the UN can take it. It's an arbiter of a dispute between states. But how do you arbiter, say, a non-state's dispute with the state? Do you call it a human rights case, or do you call it an aggression of one state against another? That kind of argument. And finally, the excuse of the US was that this is a conflict between a non-state and a state. So there is no way the UN can come into. And ultimately, nobody sponsored, and El Salvador, one small country in South America, sponsored it, but nobody actually supported the movement. So it just was put in the cold storage. So this is the problem. And also, because of this, I think the whole indigenous people's movement is necessary, because history is very, very silent on the indigenous people, the non-state people, as Scott and others call. They don't figure at all in any history. And this is because of the traditional definition of history as such, which you will find in, say, E.H. Carr's book, What is History? There's a chapter called, there's an essay called The Historian and His Facts. What is history? What is historical fact? And I'll just end with this, that there's a very good example that he gives. The idea of the Rubicon, no, we talk about the Rubicon. We know what the crossing the Rubicon is. It's coming to our own idiom as well, crossing the Rubicon. And that actually happened in 49 BC. Julius Caesar crossed the Rubicon, and that marked the start of the rebellion against Rome, that you're not supposed to cross it. If you cross it, you're challenging the state. That was the kind of warning he was given, and he crossed it. And that crossing the Rubicon has actually become a historical event. But the Rubicon apparently is a very small stream that I haven't seen it. And so many millions of people would have crossed that stream, farmers, to lovers who wanted to come in, or ordinary travelers. So many of them have crossed. None of them is history. But the only, the one that, that the year that Caesar crossed it is history. And this also points to the fact that history is actually a story of the state, that the non-state don't figure at all. My crossing that Rubicon doesn't make a difference. But if my crossing that stream is going to change the idea of a state or the story of a state, then that becomes history. So the indigenous people movement looked against this light is important because it's also trying to give voice to another stream of facts that you, for instance, the UN has actually adopted that declaration of the rights of the indigenous people, where, you know, if you look at the article, it's a 48 article document in which Article 11 to 14, you'll find the appeal, actually, for a recognition of the lives, the culture, the folklores of the formerly non-history-bearing population or state-bearing population. So this kind of, I mean, it's a way of trying to look for a different kind of a narrative of what has happened in the world. We can call it history or we can call it whatever, and it's just a matter of that. And on the, I mean, the last paragraph that I reserved for the Naga Accord, I had written an article. I started writing for the Wire, which Siddharth Bhadrajan and Siddharth Bhatia are doing. And I had also, they had also asked me to write on this when the accord was signed, August 3. So I had written that, it's a good step. Any peace effort is good. But the only problem is you have certain legacies which will have to be taken care of. In 1975, you had the Shillong Accord. And the NSCN actually rubbished that Shillong Accord. So if you're coming up now and saying, coming up with something similar to Shillong Accord, then what about that 40 years that you wasted? That 40 years, so many people would have died, so many people have suffered. If you're not coming out with something new, then you are going to be the one who is in trouble. That you better come out with something new. And I think this will be a problem for the NSCN as well, NSCN IM as well, that they will have to come up with something new. So when Ravi, R.N. Ravi said, no changes in the boundary, I think it would have hit him, because the Shillong Accord was like that. And if you're going to come out with something similar to Shillong Accord, you could have done it 40 years ago. You wasted 40 more years of our lives. 40 years, so many people would have been born, and maybe many of them had died before reaching 40. And so much has happened, and that period you'll have to explain if you're not going to come out with something creative from this. So that creative solution is something that we have to be looking for. And I think a hint of that has been given by the previous speaker, and very articulately too. Thank you very much.
So I think listen to two or three very interesting ideas there. For one, this distinction between
fixed demarcated boundaries and frontiers, more open, more fuzzy frontiers. I think that is a fascinating idea, and as a person trained in modern history, I know that demarcated fixed boundaries are something very modern. But the other interesting idea that you came up with was that there are these non-state bearing populations in the Northeast, in hilly areas, in the valleys, and they are uncomfortable with modern day state formation. And whenever modern day state formation happens, there are bound to be clashes, misunderstandings between such people and those who wish to create modern national sovereignties that are not only fixed but also centralized in some other part of the nation state. So those were two very interesting ideas. A third interesting idea that you expressed was that very often we write histories from a statist standpoint, right? Not from the standpoint of marginalized peoples, not from the standpoint of ordinary people, but from a statist standpoint. And we need to negotiate, engage with these ideas when we think of a new kind of accord that must take place in this day and age. Because after all, if we simply create an accord which reflects some of the positions that people took 40 years ago, what really is the point, right? So thank you so much. And now may I invite Mr. Khekiye Sema to speak on the subject.
I don't think I'll need that.
Challenging the state, that was the kind of warning he was given, and he crossed it. And that crossing the Rubicon has actually become a historical event. But the Rubicon apparently is a very small stream that I haven't seen it. And so many millions of people would have crossed that stream. There's farmers, to lovers who wanted to come in, or ordinary travelers. So many of them have crossed. None of them is history. But the only, the one that, the year that Caesar crossed it is history. And this also points to the fact that history is actually a story of the state. That the non-state don't figure at all. My crossing that Rubicon doesn't make a difference. But if my crossing that stream is going to change the idea of a state or the story of a state, then that becomes history. So the indigenous people movement looked against this light is important because it's also trying to give voice to another stream of facts that you, for instance, the UN has actually adopted that declaration of the rights of the indigenous people, where, you know, if you look at the article, in the, it's a 48 article, document, in which article 11 to 14, you'll find the appeal, actually, for a recognition of the lives, the culture, the folklores of the formerly non history-bearing population or state-bearing population. So this kind of, I mean, it's a way of trying to look for a different kind of a narrative of what has happened in the world. We can call it history or we can call it whatever, and it's just a matter of that. And on the, I mean, the last paragraph that I reserved for the Naga Accord, I had written an article, I started writing for the Wire, which Siddharth Bhadrajan and Siddharth Bhatia are doing, and I had, they had also asked me to write on this when the accord was signed, August 3. So I written that, it's a good step. Any peace effort is good. But the only problem is you have certain legacies which will have to be taken care of. In 1975, you had the Shillong Accord, and the NSCN actually rubbished that Shillong Accord. So if you're coming up now and saying, coming up with something similar to Shillong Accord, then what about that 40 years that you wasted? That 40 years, so many people would have died, so many people have suffered. If you're not coming out with something new, then you are going to be the one who is in trouble. That you better come out with something new. And I think this will be a problem for the NSCN as well, NSCN IM as well, that they will have to come up with something new. So when Ravi, R.N. Ravi said, no changes in the boundary, I think it would have hit him, because the Shillong Accord was like that. And if you're going to come out with something similar to Shillong Accord, you could have done it 40 years ago. You wasted 40 more years of our lives. 40 years, so many people would have been born, and maybe many of them had died before reaching 40. And so much has happened, and that period you'll have to explain if you're not going to come out with something creative from this. So that creative solution is something that we have to be looking for. And I think a hint of that has been given by the previous speaker, and very articulately too. Thank you very much.
So, Azim, listen to two or three very interesting ideas there. For one, this distinction between
fixed demarcated boundaries and frontiers, more open, more fuzzy frontiers. I think that is a fascinating idea, and as a person trained in modern history, I know that demarcated fixed boundaries are something very modern. But the other interesting idea that you came up with was that there are these non-state bearing populations in the Northeast, in hilly areas, in the valleys, and they are uncomfortable with modern day state formation. And whenever modern day state formation happens, you know, there are bound to be clashes, misunderstandings between such people and those who wish to create modern national sovereignties that are not only fixed, but also centralized in some other part of the nation state. So those were two very interesting ideas. A third interesting idea that you expressed was that very often we write histories from a statist standpoint, right? Not from a standpoint of marginalized peoples, not from the standpoint of ordinary people, but from a statist standpoint. And we need to negotiate, engage with these ideas when we think of a new kind of accord that must take place in this day and age. Because after all, if we simply create an accord which reflects some of the positions that people took 40 years ago, what really is the point, right? So thank you so much. And now may I invite Mr. Khekiye Sema to speak on the subject.
I don't think I'll need that.
There was this little boy in an ice cream parlor holding on lovingly to his ice cream when a big bully came and snatched away that ice cream from this little boy's hands. This little boy knew that there was absolutely no chance for him physically to get back that ice cream from this big, huge man. But his spirit just wouldn't allow him not to fight back for what was his. So he fought back. That little boy, you may define him to be the Nagas. And the big bully, India. Nagas are Indians by circumstance, not by choice. Now, it may offend a good number of you who are highly patriotic Indians, I'm sure. But before you take your judgment call, I hope you take certain facts called history and balance your thoughts out accordingly. Mr. Theja earlier, if you have heard him, have already given you the backgrounds, but since I'm only allowed 20 minutes, if I go through the history, we may have to spend the night here. So I have left behind a written script, a hard copy, giving you basically the background of how the Nagas' whole movement have begun, starting from the early years, even before India had been liberated from the colonial forces. So for those of you who may be interested to know exactly what did happen there and what is happening now, you can request Professor Kumar to share the copy with you to get your details. But the fact of the matter is this. Take a look at your Indian history and you will not find one single reference of Nagas of the Northeast being reflected in that history book of India. India did not know the Nagas, but neither did the Nagas know the Indians. You see? The only linkage between the Nagas and the Indian continent is the British. You know why? The British came into the Naga territory not for any other reason. The British had started their massive tea plantation in Assam, and the good old headhunters, the Nagas, from the mountains would come down, yodel and take a couple of heads in the tea gardens and run back home up in the hills. And they were disrupting the whole economy of the British, the tea gardens. And therefore, the British felt that it is important to protect their interest, economic ventures in Assam, and so started the skirmishes with the headhunters, the Nagas, up in the hills. But they had no colonial expansion intent in the hills of Nagaland because there was nothing that Nagaland or the Naga hills could contribute towards their colonial economy. There was nothing at all. The only reason why the British came into the Naga territory, therefore, was only to protect their tea plantation interests. And the simple fact of life was that they stopped the Nagas from headhunting. One good plus point. But beyond that is all a minus point as far as the Nagas are concerned, because it is the only linkage that India could claim, that India was ruled by the British and Nagas were also ruled by the British. The British did not even take control of the whole of Nagas. Like Theja had already, in 1929, when Simon Commission had come to reform the states of Indian Union, the Nagas have said, please leave us alone. We have never been under any foreign domination ever. And if you do go away, we must be left as we were, free. Now, because of that petition, that memorandum that the people of the Nagas had submitted to the Simon Commission, the Simon Commission's report had an impact in ultimately creating a perspective on the Nagas living in the frontiers into British India Act 1935, where they called Naga Hills excluded area. Okay? It is an act, a legal perspective defining the status of the Nagas. It was excluded from the rest of India, and it was called excluded area. But within the perimeters where the Nagas live, I'm usually very indisciplined with time, so.
No problem, I'll gently remind you.
Okay. Gently so that I don't hear it.
We wish to learn from you, so even if you take some extra time, it doesn't really matter.
And thank you, I don't know where I was.
So the perimeter where the Nagas lived.
Excluded area.
Hmm?
Excluded area.
Okay, yeah, excluded area. So even when the Britishers were in Nagaland, they had clearly made Nagaland or the Naga Hills excluded from the rest of the Union Reformation system. But you know, there was also the eastern part of the Nagas, the eastern Naga sector, that was defined as unadministered area. It means even the British didn't have a control over this territory in the eastern frontiers, you see? But the moment the British went off, the fact that the legal status has been defined, came the colonial disease that was contracted by the Indian leaders, in which after suffering the colonial rule for so many years, they decided to become the British again, in as far as the Nagas were concerned. And the invasion began despite the fact that the Nagas had already declared their independence on the 14th of August of 1947, a day before India was independent, Nagas were. But that didn't make any difference as far as you are concerned, or we are concerned. Nagas were that little boy holding on to his freedom, but this big gentleman was not very gentlemanly in invading the territories because it was not a part of India. So when they invaded it, the little boy was just not prepared to give up that little freedom that he enjoyed from time immemorial. And therefore he said, no thank you, we don't need you. But then when you are a bully, you are a bully. So you just won't let go. And so began this whole trouble that has been suffered between India and the Nagas. I'm afraid this is a simple way of presenting a situation, but if you really are keen to know, as I said, you need to go a little deeper. Because, as I said, it will definitely hurt your sentiment when I say, if I were to say, by way of facts of history, I am an Indian by circumstance, not by choice. You see? That's where it lands up to be. Now, the whole situation is also vitiated because of the fact that the leaders of India didn't even know the tribal people as human beings. When India became independent, Jawaharlal Nehru himself, during the Copeland land discussion, had said that there's a long frontier of tribal people that doesn't belong to Burma or doesn't belong to India. That was a time when India was still free from the colonial disease. It was an honest thought, even being expressed by people like Jawaharlal Nehru. A long frontier that doesn't belong to Burma or doesn't belong to India. Those are the honest, uncontaminated thoughts that had been expressed. People like Raja Gopalachari, the Lieutenant Governor of India, had said, Nagas deserve to be independent outside the Indian Union. But all of these personal statements made by personalities of India were just personal opinion, never translated into a national policy. And therefore, with that aggression that was bestowed against the Nagas, the whole world says Nagas are trying to secede from India. For heaven's sake, how do you secede from something that doesn't even belong to you? That you do not belong to? How do you? Can you tell me? How do you secede from something that doesn't belong to you? But that's exactly the whole world's opinion about us, that we are fighting India to secede from the Indian Union. No, we were never a part of India. So how the hell can we secede? We are like that little boy fighting the bully for the last 69 years, and comes this peace agreement finally. And you know, at that time, people like Jawaharlal Nehru has simply thought that this is a little movement, the NNC and the federal government and whatever, is a political movement that has been instigated by Christian missionaries and a few handful of educated Nagas, because at that time there was not too very many Nagas who were educated. So they said that this is a small fry movement and we should be able to quail it, submerge it within a month or two. That miscalculation was a very serious and costly mistake, because till today, we are still fighting that war, and in between then and now, more than 30,000-40,000 of Nagas have died on our side of the fence, and that many more on the Indian side of the fence. They didn't understand the human being that the tribals were. We were not equated with the human beings. Our opinion didn't bother them at all. So when the international boundary was demarcated between India and Burma, they took a simple watershed. They didn't even bother that they were on that international boundary that India and Burma share. There were families, my uncles, my aunties, living across that stupid international boundary that was created. Just like that. And during that time, not a single opinion had been sought from the tribals who belong there. So, you know, if you were to dig a little deeper, you will find that the international boundary runs through a village called Longwa. The international boundary runs right in the middle of the Chief Ang's residence. So this Chief Ang, who is a chief, crosses the international boundary every other minute without passports. That's the kind of heartless, cold division, totally disrespecting us as human beings. And that's your reality. So the whole situation has been built up like this. I'm sorry, in fact, I have not even started the subject matter itself. Now, so that's the kind of the background within which this Naga movement and the present status, where finally the government of India have understood the unique history. And when you say unique history, Nagas were not a part of India. That's being recognized as a unique situation, even though we are now a part of the Indian Union as a state. They have recognized this uniqueness of our history, and therefore they have begun the negotiation, trying to solve it through a political discourse instead. Okay? And over the years, this discourse has been going on. The more dominant group called the NSCN-IM, who has been defined to be the strongest of the factions, we have overpopulated factions in Nagaland. But they are supposed to be the dominant one, and they have made a pact to the government of India that only they should be discussed with. And this agreement has been therefore signed between the government of India and NSCN-IM. Now, NSCN-IM is a small portion of the problem. The major part of the problem of 7-8 more factions are there. Each of these factions are raising taxes, buying weapons, recruiting cadres, and that's for real. Now, IM can tell the government of India that if you talk with any of the other factions, we will stop talking with you. If government of India listens to that, then we are heading for a big trouble. Because the government of India, as usual, have not actually understood the tribals and how they live. And therefore, if they are going to continue reading the tribals the way they have read us all their lives, in which case, they are going to create another problem for the Nagas, just like the Shillong Accord did. Divide the Nagas into smaller and smaller bits. And if that is something that the government of India thinks suits their purpose, maybe it suits the political intent of one government or one party or the other, it certainly does not serve the purpose of the people, the real people, us, living on the solid ground of Nagaland, who are going to face the criticality of that wrong decisions that government of India makes with just one faction when there are eight more, who are raising, as I said, taxes, who are purchasing arms and weapons and recruiting. Now, these people are only claiming that as long as sovereignty and integration of all the tribals in the contiguous states are brought under the same umbrella, we are not going to give up. Now, rest of the other NPGs are claiming that without integration and sovereignty, the fight will go on. Now, NSCN-IM and the government of India has made more or less a very vague, confused statement saying we are going to have a shared sovereignty. We don't know what the hell that shared sovereignty is all about. And we don't know if they say integration is not going to be a part of the solution, in which case the very fundamental principle within which 1951 plebiscite had been taken into account for a full-fledged independence is not going to happen. And if they bring home anything below the status of sovereignty and integration, all the other factions that are taxing the people left, right, and center will still claim legitimacy by way of saying, we will continue to fight for sovereignty and integration. Not that they can get it from India, maybe, but the fact remains, it keeps them alive, and they want to stay alive. Why? Because they've got the guns, and they are taxing the people. Your comfort zone is being carved out already. I'm living on people's blood. The conveniences of others. Nagas are being taxed 5-6 times against one bottle of water, let's say. When this bottle of water crosses the state of Nagaland, it is taxed by the underground, it is taxed by our government system, and when it is stored in the main godown, they will have to pay again the godown tax to the underground. Then the wholesalers buy it from the godown and they will have the wholesaler's tax. Then when the wholesalers give it to the retailers at the shop level, again the underground stake sales tax from the shop. One commodity being taxed five times, and then we, the people, are paying it every day without knowing or knowingly, unknowingly. Now, we do not want this system to continue, and therefore we have said, now, let all the underground groups get together and form just one solid group, because we're not fighting for 8-9 sovereignties. We are fighting for just one sovereignty, and therefore, that many of you fighting for sovereignty doesn't make sense to us. What doesn't make sense to us is the amount of taxation that you are burdening the public with. We don't want to pay tax anymore. Either you join up or else we stop paying tax. That's the people's movement that has come out through account. Now, the whole situation is simple. If the government of India does not take cognizance of the fact that we are the stakeholders, and if we are not told exactly what that settlement is all about, how the hell do we agree to that? Now, there was this old man, a Gambara, who was literate. He sent a letter through the elder in his village to deliver a letter to the deputy commissioner at Mokokchung. This old man took the letter to the DC, and the deputy commissioner read the letter from the Gambara, and the letter said, "Lock up the man who brought you the letter." The situation here is the same. We don't know what NSCN, IM, and government of India is agreeing, and they want us to endorse it and say, clap our hands for Shabbat, pat them on the back. We don't know what we are patting. So how do we appreciate or depreciate such a situation? So we are saying, we are the stakeholders, for heaven's sake. Let us know what you are trying to agree on. And only then we will cheer with you. And if you are not able to do this, then for heaven's sake, let all the other factions also be brought on board. Let everybody discuss exactly what the demand is. And at the end of the day, I have been saying, if the underground or the NPGs, the National Movement Workers, all join together and work out the problems with the government of India, you know, at the end of the day, if they jointly bring home even a small little chicken from the government of India, the population in Nagaland would cheer like hell and say, well done. Then the population may not even talk about sovereignty or integrity. Just a chicken, man. A chicken from India. And everybody will clap their hands happily and celebrate as if we have just come to the second Christmas. So there you are. As long as all the factions are not brought on board and decisions made, there is going to be trouble, and civil war can result from a misreading of circumstances and situation. And the moderator is staring at me silently. So we will deal with some more issues if you have questions later, but at least for the sake of decency, I'll call it a day. Huh? Thank you.
Naga people is not just a socio-economic marginalization, not just a political marginalization, which it may well be, but it is also a fact that they are literally living on the physical, geographical margins of a large state. And that itself may cause problems, because that means there is a situation of compounded disadvantages, right? So that would be one way of looking at it. Another way of looking at it, as you suggested, May well be that, there are people of the valleys and the hills, and there are several people there with all their conflicts and their sharing. Nonetheless, there may be a case for creating an intermediate structure, right? You might remember, some of you, that when the cabinet mission came to this country, it said that we should have a weak center, India should remain united, there should be no partition, and for a minute I'm taking you away from the Northeastern issue, but I think there is an analogous situation here. So they said that, look, we should have one country here with a very weak center, a confederation with a weak center. There must be problems. Around regions which will form an intermediate tier between the provincial governments and a weak center. So what I learned from Pradip Sahab's intervention is that maybe we can have an intermediate tier of people of the hills and valleys of the Northeast, say between each of the provinces that constitute, each of the states that constitute the Northeast and an Indian center. And I suppose the corollary would be that it would be better for the Indian center to actually weaken itself, right? And a third issue that comes up to my mind here is this whole business of speaking not to one faction, but speaking to several people in Nagaland. We are conscious of the fact that this has to be a very slow process. It will be an arduous process. We'll have to speak to many, many different people. But the question that this raises is that if there are so many factions, what is the responsibility of the people within to bring together everybody on one platform? So while, of course, the Indians can divide, I quite understand that, by trying to privilege one faction over the other. On the other hand, I'm sure that there must be some responsibility that the different factions and groups within Nagaland also bear with regard to this. What would be their role in bringing people together? That, to my mind, would constitute a third kind of question. Having outlined these questions, I would first invite each of you to make a further comment, if you so like, to raise questions about each other's talks, maybe to synthesize the various talks if you wish to, and let us try and arrive at least some questions, some issues. I've outlined three. Maybe there are some others that need to be discussed, and then we'll open it for the floor. Would you like to talk?
Yeah, I'm not sure if what I said was actually an advocacy for weakening the Indian state so that the provinces can become stronger. But I think this is a point of view which has been forwarded by no one less than Fali Nariman in his State of the Nation. But he was talking about the making of the Indian Constitution. In 1946, the Constituent Assembly was formed. And that was a time India was in big trouble. It was, 1947, it was divided into two countries. And India was not sure whether it's going to break up further. There were so many, 560 princely states. Of them, so many didn't want to join India. Kashmir included, Junagadh, to Travancore, to Manipur, so many other places, Mysore, to so many other places were reluctant to join India. So there was a fear that India was actually going to disintegrate further. So this psychology would have actually had a bearing on the making of the Constitution as such. And he says that there are articles in the Constitution which actually shows this. For instance, the Article 3 is one of them. It's the strongest of them, in fact. An article says that India, that is Bharat, will be a union of states. That was the only suggestion that India is going to be a federation. But then Article 3, he says, is a refutation of this first article, where it says that a state can be broken up, merged into two, names changed, boundaries changed, without the consent of the state. which is like saying, telling the princely state, you don't behave, I can finish you off. I can just rub you off the map. That's the kind of message that was being said. And it says this is one of those features of the Indian constitution which is totally against federalism. And he was actually suggesting in his earlier speeches, and I've heard two other speeches before he wrote this book, where he was actually suggesting that Article 3 should be dropped, Commission of Inquiry Act 1952 should be dropped, and certain other provisions, the idea of eminent domain should be toned down, those kind of things he was suggesting. But now in the book he says that it's not possible anymore to change the basic feature of the Constitution. You can't do it anymore. So maybe it should be an agreement by which you agree to actually share these articles, that you are they are there as archives, they are there as a reminder of what India was in 1947 when the Constitution was began being made, and until 1950 when it was actually promulgated, but never to be used again. So you have Article 3 which you will never use again, or Article 2. For instance, indicates that India at the time of the making of the Constitution was not sure whether this was a finished story, that there's more to be done of the boundary, which is how using Article 2 you annexed Sikkim in 1975, that kind of thing. So he was actually suggesting that some of the features in the Indian Constitution should be actually dropped. But now that you can't drop it, you just keep it into the background, so send it off into the background, never to be used again, it's there in the cold storage. That's the kind of suggestion that he makes. And then this is the point, you know, I don't know how I actually said this in my earlier thing. Maybe I had reflected, because maybe it was there in the back of my mind and it reflected on what I said. But on the question of excluded area, I just want to put in one more point. But it was not essentially meant only for Nagaland, the excluded area, because there was also the partially excluded area and all that. You know, the Government of India Act 1919 had actually put this as an administered area. They were just left as unadministered. Before that, there was the inner line. 1873, there was the British decided to draw the inner line in Assam to make sure that, you know, it was, you know, yeah, this was the idea of protecting their revenue states against the non-revenue states. And they put that inner line along their revenue states where the tea gardens were growing. But what happened was there was tremendous pressure from the tea garden planters, as well as timber prospectors and all that, to extend the inner line into the mountains, because they wanted to use the foothills and all that. So but the British didn't want to do that. No, initially they tried. They were very, very. Imagine they were at a time under the crown, okay. But then because the they were still they were under the crown. But they began as a multinational company. They were only thinking of revenue. So they wanted to protect revenue provinces. But if the non-revenue provinces, as Mr. Khekiye has also pointed out, if the non-revenue provinces were giving trouble, then we have to control them. That's the attitude they had. So so the inner line was drawn basically on this principle, that you have the inner line. Within the inner line, we will protect you. But beyond that, don't go. Because we don't want to be taking out this punitive expedition every now and then, because that's too expensive. But they were always talking in terms of expensive. How much revenue you get from there? They were not thinking in terms of administration or the welfare of the people as such. They were only thinking about their purse. And that purse, if that purse is going to be affected, we will take out that thing. In fact, you know, I just a small digression, that, you know, in 1826, the British came to Assam just to repel the Burmese. The Burmese had come and they were threatening Bengal. So they came into Assam and took over Assam. Then after that, what happened was, you know, you have, since it was a war, they had their own regular army there, Silent Light Infantry, so many different divisions were there. But after some time, they found out that this was not cost effective, so they wanted to withdraw all the regular army. And what they did was they raised militia, like the Salawjitun. But now we can't do it because there is a constitution which is going against it, but those days they were the constitution. So they raised this people's militia. First it was called the Kashar Levy. 1835 they raised that Kashar Levy. And then in the same year, they also raised the Jorat militia. Ultimately, they merged and they became the Kashar Levy. And this Kashar Levy finally became the Assam military police, and finally became the Assam rifles. It was, the initial purpose was that, no, you don't want the army there because it's too expensive. You take them away, take them to Afghanistan on more engaging frontiers. This is a backward region. We don't have any revenue there.
But then what happened was immediately after that, by the 1930s, the Bruce Brothers came, they discovered tea. So they needed some kind of security there. That's why they raised the Assam Rifles. And the description of the Assam Rifles by the colonial historiographer, like E.A. Gate, is that, you know, it was a force which is better armed than the police, but less paid than the military. So they wanted a midway kind of a system. So they placed the Assam Rifles there. You know, what I'm basically saying is that their whole attitude was revenue. That if you have revenue, you protect it. If you don't have revenue, don't go there. But if the non-revenue areas are giving trouble, then all take measures. That's the basic approach of the British. And so 1873, they drew the inner line. 1919, they had the governor of India. 1919, this was for the whole of India. And by that, the territory beyond the inner line were declared as unadministered. Nothing there, so we won't administer it. But by 1935, the governor of India Act 1935, that's the one which declared the excluded area and the partially excluded area. And this was basically meant to partially include some of these areas. You know, the revenue area were given some rights because they were also the Indian freedom movement and all that. And because of that, the people wanted more power in the governance system. So they actually reformed, and the Governor of India Act 1935 was to reform the governance system. So they would bring in more elected people into the assembly, provincial assembly, directly elected people. So from the provincial, from their revenue areas, they allowed this thing to happen, directly elected people. From the partially excluded area, they allowed some people to come in, but nominated by the governor. They were not elected. From the tribal area, no, we will just, it's a nominal kind of thing. And in the excluded area, they were just left alone. They were not ready for this kind of governance. So they just left alone. So it was that kind of a demarcation. And also the Governor of India Act 1935 was also to partition Burma with India. Burma was with India at the time. Now the whole attitude of the Indian historiographer is that we don't remember Burma at all. It was part of India till 1937. 1935, the provision was made for the separation of Burma. But till 1937, this act was put into effect. Till 1937, Burma was part of India, and yet people don't remember Burma at all. But we will remember what is happening in Pakistan, what is happening everywhere. So India, by nature, is a very westward-looking country, not in terms of the west of in the European sense, but its history, its, you look for your antiquity, you're looking at the Indus Valley civilization, migration of the Aryan and all that. But you don't look there at all. You're very uneasy of looking towards the west, towards the east, which is why the northeast is also forgotten to a great extent, which is why, as Mr. Khekiye said, Naga was not even mentioned in the history book. And the entire northeast was not mentioned in the history book for a long time. And this is because the whole outlook, the whole psychology of the place is to just be looking west for its sustenance, for its search for antiquity. Everything is towards the east, west, which is why a place which was part of it, India, till 1937 is not remembered. And in fact, Ashok Mitra had written an article in the Telegraph, I don't remember which year, but about 5-6 years ago, saying that by the 1935 Governor of India Act, Burma was given away to, made a separate state, separate country. If in that, by the same act, the Northeast was also made into a separate country, nobody would have protested. At that time, nobody would have been aware that Northeast was part of India. And if that had happened that time, that Northeast was either clubbed with Burma or made a separate province, and that was the height of the Indian freedom movement. Imagine, in the height of the Indian freedom movement, you take away a part of India and then make it independent, and nobody notices. Not a squeak of protest from all the freedom fighters in India. So that freedom fighting was not all the East at all. Burma can go. And if the Northeast, if that time, the Governor of India Act 1935 had also said, no, Northeast can be part, can be separate. Maybe there'll be some bit of protest in Bengal and here and there, who have some ties with the Northeast, but Northeast would have gone. And that's basically the argument of Ashok Mitra in the Telegraph. And that's basically one of the problems of the whole idea of Indian history, that you are always looking to the West. There's so much concern about the West. Even now, as I said, this is so. Long ago, it was the same attitude was there, that the East is a frontier. At least a frontier is, it's not even a territory that you can take off in terms of making a factor in the definition of the nation.
I just say that given the time that we have, we've gone over a very tortuous history, and we understand the factors that are important in that history. But let us now come to the present. Where do we go from here? And I think you want to say something on that, right?
Yes.
Yeah, Mr. Pradip was view. I quite agree. Let me just give my angle. Indian constitution is very clear. And I know the students know better than me. I'm not an expert. Here, Article 1, 2, 3, 4 of the Indian Constitution. It talks about Bharat, India. Article 2 talks about how Union, Indian Union is formed. India is a union of states. When the states come together in union, it is Union of India. It is not just the people, but it is the territorial jurisdiction of that state comes together and form the Union of India. Third and fourth talk about readjustment, realignment of the territorial jurisdiction of the states. When Nagaland state was created in 1962, territorial demarcation have not been given to the state of Nagaland. There was no physical demarcation at all. This process was overlooked, skipped, assured the Naga delegation that Article 3 and 4 process will go on. In the meantime, you accept the state. The state was created. The territorial jurisdiction was not settled. And because of which the conflict with Assam, Arunachal, Manipur, all these are on. This is my understanding. And now, if Nagaland is not given its all physical territory, how can Nagaland also join Indian Union? Just the people without territory. There is also one question. British have drawn inner line, 1925. That inner line is just to protect the culture, the civilization, the vulnerable tribals from the mainland people. And now Assam claims that this inner line is the territorial jurisdiction demarcation between Assam and Nagaland. This case is still on in the Supreme Court for the last so many years. Here between Manipur and Nagaland, Nagas are claiming our traditional ancestral domain. Whereas the British demarcation and state jurisdiction, all these are conflicting. There is no clear settlement because Nagaland, when it was created, there was no physical demarcation that has taken place. Had those people, the pioneers who have given us the state, taken care to see our demarcation and our territorial jurisdiction and have gone through the parliament in exercise of Article 3 and 4, this problem could have been settled once for all. These are, I don't know, it is, these are the lapses which has given rise to all this conflict, and that is still going on.
Yeah, I think let's open it to the floor now. There'll be questions from the floor, comments, and I invite comments. And after that, I think let our panelists respond. I'm sure there are a few things that I wish to flag, but I'll wait.
I have many questions, but I'll keep it to a few. One is the idea of in some senses. So not that I want to, I'm not questioning the history. What I'm asking is the homogeneity of Nagas and this idea that both mainland India has with regard to Nagas, as well as in general when you speak, and it's and in some of my work that I've done in the Northeast as well, there are different identities that is put together as the Naga hill tribes and the Nagas themselves in mainland Naga, Nagaland itself. So I wanted to ask you about your opinions on that. And
if I may just add a little bit to that, when we talk of homogenization, are we asking whether the Nagas are culturally homogenized, or whether we are also saying that there's the question of political identities there, right? Because there is identity politics linked to the culture. So homogenization can actually operate at least two broad levels, at a cultural level, at the level of political identities.
The other was on insurgency itself, and I've been working with armed groups, but in separate areas, not in India. I've been working outside India in the Middle East with armed groups, and a lot of it comes with extortion. The Indian Army itself, when I used to work with the BNLF, have traded weapons with the BNLF directly. Those are the Bodos. Not, I don't know much about the Naga insurgent groups. So, I mean, the idea of insurgency itself in that region, the crisis of Burma, that is, I mean, India has not played a diplomatic role in Burma at all. There is a continuing crisis in Burma with their governance, and then the overflow of arms and arms training, and both within China. So, an insurgency plays this effect in terms of it excludes people, and people are caught up in between. And you can see that happen in Kashmir, in Chhattisgarh, in other places. So that's my other question on. We are looking at other factions, the UNLFW, which has come up, Kaplang. So what role will that play? And how will Naga communities, or other ethnic communities, it could be Kukis, or it could be other ethnic communities within that, deal with emerging insurgency? And
sure. I think we'll have to operate with one mic at a time, because these mics don't like each other.
Manipur is facing that other problem as well. You have a very crystallized identity which can be reshaped, which can't be reshaped. So that's another kind of problem. But you also have volatile identities, very, very malleable identities, which can be reshaped. It has its dangers, it has its plus points as well. But the fact is, these are very volatile identities and very recent ones. And also the idea of the Nagas coming together, when the Naga Club was formed immediately after the First World War. And then the First World War, as the Labour Corps, as Mr. Khekiye was also explaining, there they met, and it's there in Charles Charles's book also, that they met the Labour Corps people who were taken from here, they met, probably that's why the Kukis was also there as a Naga, because they were there, they were, no, Kukis in Manipur rebelled, but during the First World War, when they were going to take the Labour Corps, they refused to join, so there was the Kuki rebellion there. But from amongst the Nagas, there were many people who were taken there, about 2,000, some say 2,000, some say 3,000 people were taken to Europe, in the Labour Corps, and there they met, and they were treated as one group, and they were not even, they were not treated as Indian there, they were not mixed with other Indian troops. So they were there separate, and then they began to realize that there must be something similar between us. So they came back, and then they said, no, we have to do something for our people. We are seen as this way by the outside, so why should we also respond similarly? So they formed the Naga Club. And the history, of course, after that is the Simon Commission and all that happened later on. So I think the homogeneity thing began, according to many of the writers, with the First World War and the formation of the Naga Club immediately after the First World War.
Yeah. It's a very sensible question. I don't know whether we'll be able to do justice. But I think we should also give an attempt to that. Everything boils down to Naga aspiration, to live as a people, as a nation, as one nation. And because of that spirit, we have a political movement so that we become a nation of our own. Just to clarify a little notion about what Pradip has said, Kuki, they are not Naga. But Kuki is an indigenous tribe in the state of Nagaland. Recognized indigenous tribe in the state of Nagaland. But they are not a Naga tribe. Yeah.
that is one thing very clear. And now, because of this aspiration, when people decided to go for Naga homeland, then this political process started under Naga National Council. So that far was okay. But as the movement continues, and the Shillong Accord came into, I think you all know about the accord. He said that the accord divides people, accord brings people together. So this is one Shillong Accord that has been signed. And some section of people say, no, this is not our aspiration. This is not what we want. That is how the faction started. The only NNC which was divided into factions. Then factions multiplies. Now today we have 7-8 factions. And now earlier the people, they have given their full mandate. 99.9% have voted for Naga sovereignty, for self-determination. But when factions started, then the attacks also multiplied. The factions, the movement group, they started becoming a burden to the citizens, the indigenous people. And that is the biggest problem today. And now if government of India really want to bring a solution, why talk to one group and ban the other group? Why choose the biggest and leave the smallest one? Our point is, how big or how small they may be, they should all be taken together on board. Even if one biggest group says, only I will decide for the Namas. But the government of India should be bold enough to say, no, we will take all of you together. This is the leadership that we want from government of India. Not just to concede to somebody who is influential and powerful to say that I will settle with you, the rest we will finish them off. I think this should not be the attitude. If there is an attitude, there can never be a settlement. But if inclusive talk is there, if everyone is taken on board, if everyone is heard together, as Mr. Khekiye have said, even if we forget about our sovereignty, even if we get a small chicken, we will all be satisfied. The point here is our political movement have fled over for the last so many years. We only want a landing ground, a ground where we can all land and contend. This is what we want. Any solution that government of India give, as long as there is faction, there will be division. And it can never be a lasting or final settlement. But if all of them come together, good or bad, whether sovereignty, integration, or even smaller than that, still we all have come together, we all have taken that. So that is acceptable, that is honorable. This is what we are asking the government of India.
Any other comments, questions? Yes, sir.
Thank you for the panelists to educate us on the Naga problem. My question to Mr. Sema. What I viewed is that we choose history, part of history, what suits to us. What suits to us? In that, the British came to this whole of land as a traders. They occupied it. Metropolitan government came after 1857. And a different kind of a governance started. When they left us, as one of the panelists brought out, 546 riyasatains. Even this, Mysore was wanting to be seceding at that time. So we would have been coming here on visa if that would have taken place. But people's will took over and they visualized that as one landmass, we are better off. Like you have just now brought out that after First World War, the Naga Club was made, all those people who were headhunters, the basic village was one an individual city or a country. And they were killing each other. When they realized this, they became one. That oneness they have developed later on, Now we have, as a one union of India, why we have not developed that oneness further ahead? Why we have frozen ourselves there only? In a human race, development is essential. Now, another panelist now has brought out that today that insurgents are a big problem to the indigenous people. It is miserable to think that people are thinking that these people are a burden on us, and yet people are not throwing them away, and the civil society is not rising against them. Isn't it the civil society and educated persons to educate them on this? That is first part. Second part is that since 1962, the state of Nagaland has been created, and as far as the self-governance is, a lot of powers have been self-governance is there. What is the state of Nagaland has learned out of that self-governance, and to even to control this insurgence and ameliorate the situation of a common man there, indigenous, their own brethren? Because we know that there are so many tribes and there are no commonness. They all have different dialects, different cultures, different festivals. Even if you just now some panelists have given example of a Chakisang and Tangkhuls. Even between Chakisang and Tangkhuls, there are Pachuris who says that we are different, however minor they may be. So, sir, have you want to develop yourself further beyond that 1919 and think of beyond integrating purely and your own indigenous solution and bringing before the table with people of India also can accept it?
Any more questions?
Yes.
My questions will be question to that little boy with the help of Khekiye, respect Khekiye Sema. So the morning which I saw in the newspaper about in the headlines in the newspaper that some tribes, the Naga, was on the newspaper, I was shocked to see that how come the world is changing. Anyway, I'm glad that the struggles of the Naga have been accepted and known by the Indian government of India. And to some extent, I feel that these accord probably a consensus, which interlocutor R. N. Ravi said in an interview. Even this, the initial step of the accord was like a Pandora box. The moment the initial signing has already occurred a lot of ethnic chaos, troubles in the neighboring states which Naga has situated. So if I were to ask to this little boy that what is his opinion about these consensus moving forward, and what are the alternatives or the like probable solutions to these ethnic problems?
Hello. Yes. Thanks for coming. All of you have given a wonderful speech, I should say. Thank you for that. And my first question goes to Sir Pradip. Sorry. So, first of all, I'm from Manipur, and my name is Shimra. I'm doing here law and governance in Nepal. So, in Manipur, recently there are so many chaos. Like there is IPR problem, and then peoples of tribals are demanding for separate administration. And the Nagas in Manipur are also demanding like for Naga integration, whereas Manipur government, especially the Maidis, are like strongly like or firmly stand for Manipur integrity. So how do you comment on that? So my second question to Sir Khekiye Sema. So yesterday I read some script, I should say, articles, and I watched some like video in YouTube. Like Nifilio, yesterday there was a Naga student, Precious Smith, holding Delhi, New Delhi. So Nifilio like says, he stated that this NSCN and Indian government accord is just a just a framework, and that opportunity should not be missed. On the other hand, see Nagaho like represent more than 48 tribe of Nagas. They are also supporting to the framework, means this recent accord. Naga Student Federation also support directly, indirectly, whereas many educated youngster Nagas are like, we don't want to give a comment on that, because until we know the content, we don't want to say we are support, we will accept or we will reject. And I'm on that, like, you know, category. And like, I have heard that last three months, I have heard that NSCN are campaigning in New Delhi. But we don't know whether it's true or false. Whether it is true or false, but I come to know that it is true. And again, we have like some news from unknown sources that NSCN are also campaigning in Europe for their sovereignty. I don't know how far it is like true or false. So I just want to know your comment. Thank you.
Okay. Look. It is important that you keep track of the actual principle within which a certain stand has been made. That's your history, okay? But your question about why continue to define your distance from the mainland when everybody else has just joined up and created the convenience of life that betters everybody's conditions, right? The first primary responsibility that anybody wants in life is an identity, right? And a dignity. If you have an identity and a dignity and your rights are respected, then no matter what happens, you can comfortably adjust with any events and situations that come up. Now, the insecurity of the people, as have already been explained by the generations before, is in a simple cycle. Then now we have the persecution of the minority by way of religion, Muslims or Christians being persecuted all over the countryside. You know, all kinds of uneasiness that keep bothering your mind to say if you are a minority, because we are, Naga population is not even as equal to one municipal ward of Calcutta, for heaven's sake. Huh? So when you look at the whole nation, unless there is some real solid ground within which, no matter what happens, my identity, my right, will not be preserved. Right? That's the more the focus within which they are trying to work out the problem. But mind you, there are present generations of people who definitely are aware of the changing circumstances of the global village circumstances, okay? And they are talking about it even within the Naga community. And they believe that to be the reality, is it? And they also look at the possibility that China, on the other side, generally waving flags to Nagas, saying you fight India, we will back you up, kind of a encouragement. But the sensible Nagas also look at what happens to Tibet. Yeah? And Tibet definitely is a bigger country than Nagaland, yes. If you were to look at it from that perspective, then where would Nagas be? Yeah? In the ocean of China. Yeah? So Nagas are also fairly aware of our circumstances, and therefore there is a moderated look at the whole situation, but very carefully looking at this possibility, because Article 371A gives us certain basics, okay? But when it comes to a thing like natural resources, now the dispute is on oil. Oil is a natural resource of the Naga. The Naga are above the ground and below the ground. If it is in Nagaland, belongs to us. Indian government says, no, not below the land. Now, if you start defining the rights given to you by way of economic considerations of your own at the cost of the tribal, you see, situations of confidence disappear. And the consistency within which Government of India has conducted accords and agreements, like the 9-point agreement starting. You see, before the ink is dry, you violate it. Now, how can people like us, the minority, who can be just like a carom board, you know, ticked away at will by anybody, how can we find anchor in somebody that doesn't believe in allowing us to anchor by violating all our rights, violating all, and then defying your legality in every respective corner that you cross? You see? So India must give some kind of an honorable platform within which that honor that we can believe upon is shown to us. And then those moderate thoughts of why? Whether it is with China or with India, they feel that probably it's better off with India because it's a democratic world. With China, you get, you drown in your communism. There are serious thoughts being peddled, and whatever you say, the general feeling is it is always better to be with India. The only thing is that three little things, your identity, your dignity and your rights being given complete assurance, not to be meddled with and trifled with the way India has done with all the agreements. Huh? The 16-point agreement also calls for integration of all the inhabited areas. India has not implemented that. And now it has become a serious issue because they didn't handle those issues at a given point of time when it could, I think. Okay? So, not knowing your own people is the problem of the Government of India's attitude within which they have been handling the tribe. Now we are trying to give them the signal, for heaven's sake, we are also human beings. Please do listen to us and we know what hurts us most. The shoe is being worn by us, not you. We know where it hurts. So please, be honorable. And as I said, if all Nagas begin to feel under the same thing, what you are saying, I have already said, if collectively the underground bring home a chicken on a united day, if they bring home a, even among the chicken, the smallest one, Nagas will be happy. That's what I said. Okay? So in as far as your question is concerned, the idea of division or wanting to stay away is not the issue. Trying to define your own security.
Shall we come back to it if we have time? Right? I know that you have a question, but we'll come back to it. We'll still come back. Yes, but there are other questions that have not been answered as yet. Would anybody want to respond?
I forgot the lady there. Her questions.
Even while it is simply a framework agreement, and this skepticism causes anxiety and crises, how do we go forward with building a framework agreement into a more genuine accord? That is the question.
You see, in fact, the problem starts with the secrecy surrounding the framework. We don't know what the hell this framework is all about. And when the issue of integration, as much if it is something within that framework that comes out to say that all the Naga integration of all the Nagas in other states will also be taken into account, it breaks and opens out a massive Pandora's box because you have all the other three states fighting the issues. Yeah, right? So, our problem at this point is, even if it be so, if the government of India is going to integrate all the Naga in other states also, well, what is there to hide? One time or another, it's going to have to be implemented. Everybody is going to know. But before it is happening, let us know exactly what these
terms and conditions
are. And how do we agree without even knowing? This is our dilemma. And so the question of taking this forward is only when we know exactly what the contents are for us to take it forward. But at this point in time, we don't even know what to take forward.
Sure. Right? Would any of you want to respond to this question?
Yes. And also, before I go to Shibra, let me just also try and put a picture of what is happening before her question. I mean, in attempting to answer her question. I think in many ways this framework is more like putting a cart before a horse. You have an idea of the cart, and then you're trying to round up the horses, you know, where to put it. And that kind of thing is actually, has also happened in Burma. Recently they had that nationwide peace agreement. There too they have 8 insurgent groups signing, although the major groups have not signed. The Kachins have not signed, the Boers have not signed, and the Kokangs have not signed. Who are still fighting, they have not signed. And without actually, you know, when you sign an accord, you start talking, and then when you come to some kind of consensus on issues, then okay, we'll put on that much, we've agreed to this much, then you sign that agreement, even if it's a framework thing. But what is happening now is that you agree first and then decide what to agree on. And I think that's the problem. I hope it works, but then the problem is basically that. That you agree and then say what to agree, without knowing what to agree on. And going to Shimra's question about, I think basically it's about the Ill-Valley conflict in Manipur. And I don't want to really say this is the answer, because it's too immediate. And also, people attribute all kinds of vested interests. So I will not try and answer that directly. But let me just allude you to certain theories which have come out on the idea of violent geography. That, you know, you have certain geographies in which conflict is embedded. As for instance, you know, Robert Kaplan has written this book called Revenge of Geography, which is very interesting. I think it's a worthwhile book for anybody to read. And he talks about, I'll just give you one example of conflict that comes because of geography. And he's talking about the Nile River, Egypt. I mean, so much of Egypt depended on Nile. So the entire Egyptian civilization is supposed to have been nurtured by the Nile River. So it's very important for Egypt. And also the river, it's important for so many economic reasons as well as culturally, so many reasons. One of them is that apparently the wind blows against the current. If the river flows this way, the wind blows that way. So if you want to go upstream, then you just put up your sail and the wind takes you upstream. When you come down, you just pull down your sail and the current brings you down. So you don't have to be expending so much of energy. So it's very navigable and it's very useful, and it has actually also, because of its, because of the alluvium that it brings down, it's also made that valley fertile, parts of that fertile crescent where human civilization is supposed to have begun and all that. So it's very, they're embedded in the cultural memory of Egypt that Nile is sacred. It's a Norwegian culture. And now Nile is very, very small because of overuse of water and all that. And it's also not as useful, as vital as it used to be 5,000 years ago or 2,000 years ago. And yet Egypt still considers the upstream touches that river, they will go to war. Ethiopia, Sudan, anywhere, any upstream countries, if they touch on the Nile, Egypt is still ready to go to war. And I think that kind of thing is happening in the Hill Valley conflict there in Manipur as well. It's a question of survival. If you're just, if any of the communities are going to be strangulated because of sudden redemarcation of boundaries or redemarcation of the political setup, it's going to be opposed. And it's determined, predetermined by geography. And I think we should take care of this. If something is inevitable, then I think we should be learning to actually accommodate each other. And that's the only way. And the Hill Valley thing is also very much there in, for instance, Kashmir. We've been talking about the India-Pakistan conflict in terms of politics. You know, the Hindu king wanted to join India, and then there's the Muslim population who wanted to be more aligned to Pakistan. That kind of thing we've been learning. But the fact is, you know, the Indus Valley civilization was actually supported, I mean, nurtured by the 5 rivers of Punjab, and 6th one, Indus, all of them merged together to form the Indus and all that. And all these rivers originate in Kashmir. Either originate in Kashmir or passes through Kashmir. So it's a major catchment area. So Kashmir is important to Pakistan and India because of this as well. At the back of the mind is that this importance would not have been forgotten by those who are actually behind these conflicts. So I think we have to be looking for these geographies. And since we cannot change geography, geography is given, you just can't change it. So we have to accommodate that geography and then say. And in the case of Manipur, I think it's very, very interdependent, although we don't recognize it. You see the hills, or the valley up here, okay, or the rivers originate from the hills. So the valley and also all the mountain passes are through the hills. So for the valley, the hills are important. And for the hills too, without actually recognizing it. You see the hill population coming and settling in the valley. Because the hills now, the forests have disappeared more or less. I mean, only in some patches it's there. Wildlife has more or less disappeared. So the lifestyle of the people there once used to be hunting and gathering and all that, and a little bit of agriculture. So if the wildlife is not there, what do you hunt? If the forest is not there, what do you gather? That kind of thing is happening, so people start coming down into the valley. So it's an interdependent kind of an economy. And if you try to disrupt that, it is no longer politics, it's just survival. So there's going to be conflict. And we should be recognizing these underlying reasons for conflict. And if you recognize those reasons, then maybe you can look for a better solution to the problem.
Thanks. We are running out of time. I know some people would want to ask questions. Is there somebody dying to ask a question?
Please don't die.
Which is why I asked, right? Shall we bring it to a close? May I try and synthesize the whole discussion? And in doing so, let me also place an argument before you, right? Let me take everybody back to Gayatri's initial two questions and to the responses that these gentlemen gave to those two questions. I won't repeat the questions because that will waste time, but what is the point really? The point is that initially in Nagaland, a village was an entity in its own right. You had so many different, completely sort of atomistic identities, village-based, until about 1918 to 1929, end of the First World War to the Simon Commission. Various larger circumstances led to the fact that people came together and created a sense of Naga identity. For various reasons, they could see the commonalities in their way of life, in their language, in their geographies, so on and so forth, and so created a sense of identity. But that sense of identity was still, broadly speaking, an ethnic identity, right? So you probably know Michael Ignatieff's work, where he says that some nation states are defined by ethnicity, whereas there are other nation states, very large nation states, composed of many different ethnicities, which are defined not by ethnicity, but by common citizenship, by a civic sense of belonging. The belongingness is to the idea of common rights-bearing citizens coming from different ethnicities. So all the different homelands, now if I were to transpose the argument from the individual level to community, then the argument is that all the different homelands come together to create a civic nation state. On the other side of the subcontinent, in the northwest frontier province, we all know that Khan Ghaffar Khan was able to create, in a classic situation of potential ethnic unity, a sense of civic nationalism, where belongingness was not defined in terms of Pathan identity by the red shirts, but defined in terms of equal citizenship for all. So I think our panelists would agree to that, especially because, as Pradip said, there is this important matter of democratic participation and power sharing. If you can create adequate formulas for power sharing, people across ethnicities will come together. And as he said in the end, or towards the end, that look, it's not a question of we don't want to think in terms of larger identities. We do, but we must trust people. For trust to happen, we must be able to see that India wants to respect our identity, our dignity, and our resources, wants, believes that we have a voice, not just the fact that it listens to our voice, but that we are the makers of our own destiny. We are the ones who wield power over our own selves. This sense, if we feel India is going to give us, then other things being equal, he said that, other things being equal, we feel here, at least in this country, there is a democratic, some kind of a democratic setup, not a perfect one, not one that's complete, but it's a democracy in the making, and we'd be willing to be equal partners in such an enterprise. So this is what I take back from the entire discussion, right? With the one additional factor that if in the first place we, this little boy as you mentioned, and as he mentioned, if he is to think of walking hand in hand with Goliaths, then of course there has to be a sense of, you know, tell us what the terms and conditions of this walk are, right? Tell us what the terms and conditions of this last accord are. Once we know that, we have a discussion. We feel that there is a chance of civic nation state building here with many ethnicities coming together. We'll definitely give that chance, a good sort of voice, right? Thanks.